Nice job, Char. Thank you for filling in today. David Roach, our regular pianist, is on vacation today, and so Char graciously is filling in. So thank you so much. Good morning and welcome. Good to have you all here this morning. And we still got a few folks rolling in, so that's great, too. A couple of quick announcements before we begin our worship service. This was handed to me before we started. This rose is the first rose of the year or the season. I'm getting the nod from Lois back there from Sally Mathis Memorial Garden. So praise God for the roses coming up. I had an announcement handed to me. Children's Church restart next Sunday, April 18th. Parents, grandparents, guardians, whoever brings the kids, ask to bring the children directly to the fellowship hall before worship begins, and then pick up the children in the fellowship hall after worship is over. So beginning next week, good news, we will restart the children's ministry, Children's Church, 11 o'clock in the fellowship hall. Looking at the bulletin, the Annie Armstrong collection. Today will be the last Sunday for the Annie Armstrong collection. Those of you who are not familiar with Annie Armstrong, the Southern Baptist Convention has two annual missions drives. The one at Easter time is Annie Armstrong for North American missions. And then at Christmas, we have the Lottie Moon at, for international missions. So there should be an envelope in your bulletin if you would like to give to that mission. Then please just put your donation in that envelope and drop it in the collection plate on your way out. There is a council meeting this Tuesday at 7 o'clock. All council members are expected to attend. All church members are invited to attend. Next Sunday, we will be up at Williams Place again, and we take the ministry up to the folks at Williams Place in Davidson every third Sunday. And so I actually got a call from Debbie, their events person, and we are going to be back inside again. Finally, we had to do it outside on the patio, but now we're back in the chapel inside, so we should have better attendance as well. I guess for Easter, we had about a dozen people or so, so that was pretty good. And speaking of attendance, we had 45 people in church last Sunday, which was the highest number since reopening, since COVID, so praise God for that as well. The only other announcements I believe we have are the Wednesday events. The men's prayer breakfast is 7 o'clock every Wednesday morning in the fellowship hall. It goes from 7 to 8. We have fellowship and we have a devotion, and bring your own breakfast with you. Wednesday afternoon, we have Bible study at 2 o'clock that is available via Zoom and also in person. And then Wednesday night at 6:30, we have another Bible study, and that is in person or via Zoom, and all that information is on the back. And, of course, we wrap it up at 7:30 with choir practice on Wednesday night here in the sanctuary. The other thing, and Beth, can you pull up that next slide? I hope it's the right one. There he is. Okay. So a few weeks ago, we started this little ministry called The Adventures of the Apostle Paul. And you might be able to see in between the two children there a little red figure that's a paper cutout of the Apostle Paul. We were trying to get the kids re-engaged in the children's church and the church, and so we created this little laminated Apostle Paul, and he gets mailed to each of the children, and then they take him around wherever they go and take pictures and post it to the Facebook page, and then when they're done for the week, they mail Paul to the next family, and they can have adventures with Paul as well. So there's the Jackson and Preston Hernquist down in Orlando, and they took the Apostle Paul all the way to Orlando. So maybe he went to Disney World or something, but anyhow, so that's just cute stuff. All right, any other announcements before we begin worship? I don't see any. So Terry, could you please lead us in worship?
Once again, be my honor. In the third chapter of Colossians, the Bible says, "But now you must rid yourself of all such things as these: anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with these practices and have put on a new self, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here there is no Gentile or Jew, uncircumcised or circumcised, barbarian, Scythian, slave or free, but Christ is all and is in all. Let's stand as we sing our first hymn of the day. It's hymn number 583 in your hymn book. It's called You Are My All in All. Let's stand. And all God's children said, amen. Amen. You may be seated.
I always take that mic off just in case Dan forgets to mute it and y'all wouldn't want to hear me singing. So.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you, Char. Thank you. Are so kind. Okay, so now it is time for praise and prayer requests. Before we go to that, something I did not mention during the announcements, and I just, since we have so many visitors, in front of you is a visitor card. If you would like to fill that out and drop it in the collection plate on the way out, we'd love to know that you've been here, and I will reach out to you. My information, by the way, my phone number and email are on the front of the bulletin if you have any questions for me. And then also in front of you is the Baptist Faith and Message. This is the statement of faith of the Southern Baptist Convention, which we adhere to. And if you have any questions about what we believe, it's all in here. And if you have any questions about that, you can reach out to me and we can discuss whatever you'd like to discuss. All right. Praises and prayer requests. We've got a few here. One actually was brought to me just this morning, and I'll mention it. Mike Callahan, who usually is out at the front door, ruptured a disc in his back, so he's out of commission this morning. So please remember Mike Callahan in your prayers. We also always pray for the church, and not only our church, but the two other churches that meet here. Revive Iglesia Cristiana meets before us, and then the Kachin Baptist Church meets after us, so we continue to pray for them. Not just them, but the churches worldwide, particularly those who are persecuted, and we have been lifting up the country of Myanmar. The folks who come to the Kachin Baptist Church are actually from Myanmar. Most of them are refugees. And if you've been reading the paper, there was a military coup about 2 months ago in Myanmar, and it is very violent there. And the Christians there, among others, are being oppressed. So please remember them there. We pray for our government and our president and all the leaders. We pray for our country and the military, our first responders. We prayed travel and mercies for the Browns, and apparently that worked well, so you all back. Good to have you here. And all those who are traveling for Easter, Jesse Kroll, we lifted up Jesse and continue to lift up Jesse Kroll, longtime member of this church. Jeff Kittle, Marjorie, which is Priscilla Morris's stepmother, Carol Newman, as I recall, her cancer had come back. Any other news, Beth? Newell, yeah. Oh, heavens. Oh, my. Okay, so she's in a wheelchair. Okay, a rental house. She needs a rental house here in Cornelius to be closer to her family also. Okay, okay, very good. Bobby Norman, I spoke to Bobby, and Michael's here today. Bobby had gotten very banged up in her car accident. The car was totaled. That's about a month ago now, I guess, right, Michael? She had a concussion and actually a cracked sternum, so she is still recovering from that, but Lord willing, she'll be back soon. Praise for the 45 worshipers we had in person for Easter Sunday. And so praise God for that. Praise for the beautiful weather we have today, and praise that you all are here today. So thank you for being here. Any other prayers or praises to lift up this morning? Yes. Buddy Davis had the bones in his face cracked in an accident. Operation on Tuesday. Okay, thank you. Any? Oh, you sure? So that was in Rock Hill? I didn't even hear about that. Oh my goodness. Heavens. Shooting in Rock Hill. All right, and then Carol is your sister. Okay, Carol Roy. All right. Anything else? Unspoken prayer requests? Sure, we have many. Let's take it all to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning with praise and thanksgiving on our lips as always, because you are worthy of praise. And so we lift up your name in glory and reverence for all the many wonderful things that you have done for us and in us and through us. And as you continue to do things in us and through us, Lord, we pray that you will help us to expand your kingdom. Lord God and Father, we lift up each and every cause that we lifted. We lift up every single praise to you, because, again, you alone are worthy of praise. So, Lord, as we go about our lives, let us know that everything that we do is a reflection on you if we call ourselves Christians. So we need to mind our ways and do what's right in your sight, not only for the goodness here, but to, again, honor your name. So, Lord God and Father, I just ask that you would bless each and every person here. You'd bless every person that we've lifted up, and even those who are unspoken. Bless all these issues that are going on, Lord, especially now this Rock Hill shooting that I just learned of. And, Lord God and Father, just assure us once again of your presence and of the goodness that comes through you and your Son, Jesus Christ alone, in whom we pray. Now, in the past, at this time, we would pass the collection plate. We don't do that anymore because of COVID. So if you would like to leave a donation, a tithe or offering, the collection plate is in the back. You can just drop it off on your way out. For those of you who are watching on Facebook Live, if you want to continue to support the ministry of this church, you're welcome to send your donation into the P.O. Box, First Baptist Church of Cornelius, P.O. Box 100, Cornelius, North Carolina, 28031. Or you can use the donate page on the website. And again, all of your contributions and donations and offerings are greatly appreciated. Thank you so much for your generosity. Sure.
In the ninth chapter of Luke, verse 23, the Bible says, "Those who would come after me must take up their cross daily and follow me." Let's stand as we sing hymn number 318, "I Believe in a Hill Called Mount Calvary." Amen. You may be seated. Well, now let's go to our Heavenly Father and thank Him for all the tithes and offerings that were brought into His churches around the world today. Our most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, it is such a wonderful blessing to be able to call You our Heavenly Father, to call You our most high, most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, the first person of the Holy Trinity, the Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the Creator of us all, of this universe and everything in it, Lord. How wonderful it is to have a personal street to You, personal line to Your throne, Lord. Thank You for being our Heavenly Father that's never too busy to hear us pray, to hear us fall on our knees to You. We do thank You for our church and what it means to each and every one of us here. We thank You for those that went before us and laid the foundation for this church and all the churches around the world, Lord, that are faithful to Your name, that are called Your churches, Lord, that are called Christian churches that bear Your name. We pray that You'll undergird all the tithes and offerings that were brought into these temples of worship all around the world. We pray that You'll undergird them, that You'll multiply them, Lord, like You did so many times in the Bible. You'll take our tithes and offerings, Lord, and multiply them for the use of Your kingdom here on earth. That through them and through our efforts, Lord, we can draw more people to You and to a loving relationship with You, Heavenly Father. Help us use them, Lord, to fill the world with Your love. Help us use them, Lord, to make the world a better place to live in. Help us use them, Lord, to do Your work. Help us use them, Lord, for Your glory and Your glory alone. Please forgive us for our many sins and shortcomings. Help us all to be a blessing to Your ministry each day. Help the things that we do here and in our lives every day. Help them be sweet music to Your ears and a blessing to those that come in contact with us, that we might glorify Your name. Beautiful, holy name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, we pray. Amen. Now pray for our choir as we try to sing for you. Calvary covers it all.
Redemption complete.
take this time to prepare our hearts and minds to receive His word today.
One announcement I didn't make, it actually came late Friday. I got a call from the Mecklenburg County Department of Public Health. If you may recall, a little over a month ago, I had reached out to the Department of Health offering to use the church as a vaccine clinic. Thanks to actually Mike Miltick, one of our town commissioners who was with Gibby Harris last week, he put a bug in her ear, and that helped get things rolling anyway. So they called me Friday. And they're going to come out on Tuesday and do a site visit. And hopefully shortly after that, we'll be able to have a COVID vaccine clinic here at the church for the community. And so I'll keep you apprised of those developments. But just be in prayer for that we make that happen. And for those who want to get the vaccine who haven't gotten it yet, it will be available here locally at the church. So praise God for that. Our scripture reading today is in the Gospel according to Matthew chapter 5, verses 33 through 37. If you are able, please stand for the reading of God's word. And again, this is Matthew chapter 5, beginning at verse 33. Again, you have heard that it was said to our ancestors, "You must not break your oath, but you must keep your oaths to the Lord." But I tell you, don't take an oath at all, either by heaven, because it is God's throne, or by the earth, because it is His footstool, or by Jerusalem, because it is the city of the great king. Do not swear by your head, because you cannot make a single hair white or black. But let your yes mean yes, and your no mean no. This from the evil one. And all God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. So prior to becoming a pastor, which was only, I guess, about 5-6 years ago now, I had a 30-year career in sales. And in the late 90s, I was working for a company called the Wellness Plan of North Carolina. Most of what I did was healthcare sales. And we worked with independent agencies, health insurance agencies across the state. And one of those agencies was out in Shelby, North Carolina. It was called the J.L. Suttle Agency. And it was founded by a gentleman named J.L. Suttle and his partner, Buck Archer. Now, Buck Archer and J.L. had returned from World War II, and together they established this insurance agency. And it grew over the years, and by the time I knew Buck in the late 90s, he was well into his 70s. But he was one of those men of that greatest generation. He was one of those men who honored integrity and looked for honesty and that sort of thing. And one day when we were having a meeting and my boss was there, he took my boss aside and he said, "I work with David because I can trust him." And he said, "David Judge's word is his bond." And I never forgot that. For someone to say, your word is your bond. Particularly a gentleman coming from that generation, that older generation, meant a great deal to me as a young man in sales. And I did work hard to have that reputation for honesty, and Buck saw it, and consequently he did business with our agency. And I tell you that story because honesty is so important, and having a reputation for honesty is so important. So important for us in particular as Christians that we should have a reputation for honesty. And by our honesty, we glorify God and we open doors to share the good news of Jesus Christ. And so today we're going to look at the passage here in the Sermon on the Mount. And we're coming back to the Gospel of Matthew. We had taken a couple of weeks off for the Easter season, but now we're back into Matthew. And if you recall, we're in the Sermon on the Mount. The Sermon on the Mount goes from chapter 5 until chapter 7 of Matthew. He spoke about different matters of the heart, anger and lust. He talked about divorce just recently, which in of itself is a vow or a promise. All of these things are matters of personal character. And now he's going to address this idea of honesty, of oath-taking. And he starts out by quoting the law, as he always does, in the familiar formula of, you have heard that it was said, but I say to you. And so let's take a look at that, beginning in verse 33. He says, again, you have heard that it was said to our ancestors, you must not break your oath, but you must keep your oath to the Lord. So where does he get that from? Well, it comes from Numbers chapter 30, verse 2, which says, when a man makes a vow to the Lord or swears an oath to put himself under an obligation, he must not break his word. He must do whatever he has promised. All right, so it's very clear in Scripture that if you make a vow or an oath to the Lord, you are to keep that promise and fulfill it. So what is an oath or a vow to the Lord, you might ask? Well, it's a promise or a statement that's backed up or reinforced by appealing to a higher authority, and in this case, the Lord himself. You might hear people say, I swear to God, whatever it might be. And when I say, I swear to God, or I take an oath or vow before the Lord, if I am lying, I am not only lying to you, I am also lying to the Lord. And so this becomes something very serious. Now, why would someone make a vow or swear an oath in God's name if it is so serious? Well, they feel a need to be more credible. Right? If I say something to you, you can take it at face value. But if I say, I swear to God, whatever it might be, that gives it credibility. It gives it a sense of assurance. It removes doubt from your mind. David must be serious. He said, I swear to God. And we see this in our culture today. Most often we see it with government officials and within civil authority. Police officers take an oath. If you're in the military, you take an oath of enlistment. The oath of enlistment for the Army goes like this. I, David Judge, do solemnly swear that I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic, that I will bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and that I will obey the orders of the President of the United States and the orders of the officers appointed over me according to the regulations and uniform code of military justice, so help me God. And those words at the end are a part of that oath. Now, it's interesting to me that the only constitutionally mandated oath that does not include, so help me God, is the presidential oath of office. It doesn't include it in the Constitution, although most presidents do add it on anyway. All right, so when Joe Biden took the oath of office and he put his hand on that Bible, he at the end, although he's not required by the Constitution, still said, so help me God. So this is the individual making a promise or making an oath with God as his witness. We may be called to do that as well. If you go into a court and you're a witness, Right? Do you swear to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth? So help you God. Right? So it is very common in our culture to make an oath. So the first question I would ask is, have you ever taken an oath before God? And if you did, do you recognize, did you understand the weight of that oath because you made that oath in God's name? And it carries weight because there are consequences, deeper consequences, when we make an oath before the Lord. And that's why Jesus then in verse 34 says, but I tell you, don't take an oath at all. Don't take the oath at all. Why is Jesus opposed to us taking the oath, an oath to the Lord in particular? Well, because, as I said, the serious consequences to it. If you go back at verse 33, where he quotes Numbers, you must keep your oaths to the Lord. That word that is translated as keep in Greek is apodidomai. It means to pay or perform a duty that is owed, like a debt or taxes or wages due to an employee. So it's more than just keeping it. You have an obligation to perform that duty. And your obligation when you make that promise in the Lord's name is not just to the person whom you promised, but it's also now a promise to the Lord. And there are two consequences, according to Scripture, if you don't keep that promise to the Lord. The first one is you profane the name of God. Leviticus 19:12 says, do not swear falsely by my name, profaning the name of your God, I am the Lord. So if you do not perform your duty, do not fulfill your promise or oath, when you make it to the Lord, the first thing you have done is you have profaned his name. You have used his name in vain. Second thing, it is counted against you as sin. Deuteronomy 23:21, if you make a vow to the Lord your God, do not be slow to keep it, because he will require it of you, and it will be counted against you as sin. That same truth carries over into the New Testament. James, the brother of Jesus, writes, above all, my brethren, do not swear either by heaven or by earth or by any other oath, but let your yes be yes and your no be no, so that you may not fall under judgment. Okay? James there quotes Jesus almost word for word, but then he adds in the reason why. Because if you break your oath before the Lord, you will fall under judgment. It will be counted against you as sin. So these are two very serious consequences. If we break our oath before the Lord, we profane his name, and we are sinning against the Lord. And there's other possible consequences to our own reputation. But given the possible consequences, the people of the time started swearing their oaths by a lesser authority. Right? I know I want to give it weight, but I don't want to go as far as God. So let me say, I swear by heaven. But that might be too much. Let me bring that down a notch. I swear by earth. Or maybe I'll bring that down even further. I swear by Jerusalem. Or maybe I don't really have much confidence in myself, so I'm going to bring that bar really low and say, I'll just swear by the hairs on my head. Right? All of these different things, as you can see, progressively come further and further down. You lower and lower the bar because you believe in yourself less and less. But Jesus says, don't swear by heaven because it's God's throne. Don't swear by earth because it's his footstool. Don't swear by Jerusalem because it's the holy city, the city of the great king. And don't swear by your own head because you have no power over your own head, not even to make one hair white or black. At the end of the day, everything belongs to God. So it doesn't matter what you swear by, you're still swearing by him. And so when we consider consequences to breaking the oath, take it again into today's context. If I lie in court while I'm under oath, that's perjury. I can go to jail for that. If I'm an elected official and I break my oath of office, I can get fired, dishonorably discharged, not reelected. If I tell you a lie. Just simply, I make myself out to be a liar. I prove myself to be untrustworthy. And the irony to it all is, I swore to God because my word wasn't good enough to begin with. Why would I have to say I swear to God? Because you don't really trust me, and frankly, I don't trust myself. So there's a certain irony here. But let us not ever forget, the Old Testament consequences carry through. If I swear to God and I don't fulfill that promise, then I have profaned his name and I've also sinned against him. I want you to think about, if you have ever taken a vow before God, have you broken that vow? And if you had broken that vow, what kind of consequences did you experience? I can tell you that if you broke a promise to somebody, you proved that you are untrustworthy. If you swore by God, you profaned his name and you sinned against him. And if you break an oath or a promise, it's a sin against God, it's a sin against the person you promised it to, and frankly, it's a sin against your own character, because you've proven that you're untrustworthy. And so this is very serious stuff. And so Jesus goes on and says, don't do it at all. But instead, verse 37, he gives us a solution. Here's what you should do. Don't swear by God or heaven or earth or any of those others. Here's what you need to do. Verse 37, let your yes mean yes and your no mean no. Keep it simple. Just tell the truth at all times. If you're honest, that's all that's needed. There's nothing more required. People will develop trust with you. And when you tell them yes, they'll accept your yes. And when you tell them no, they'll accept your no. No other reason to bring in the Lord to back you up. Your word will be your bond, and you'll be respected for it. Jesus says anything else is from the evil one or is from evil. Well, why? Because I'm putting myself at risk to sin against you, against the Lord, against my own character. And I'm putting myself at risk of profaning his name. It's evil to put yourself at risk to sin. You don't want to see how close I can get to sin. I've heard people say things like that to me. Well, how far can I go until I sin? Don't even begin to think that way. All right? You're going to get yourself to the edge of the cliff and fall off. When I was in sales, I was taught something very important, something you can take away. Under promise and over deliver. You may have even heard that. Under promise and over deliver. The reason why I had a reputation for honesty was because I under promised. If they asked me if I could do something and I knew we could do it, not a problem. If I wasn't sure, I'll get back to you. But don't overpromise. One of the mistakes a young salesperson will make is they will overpromise and then they get stuck having to try to fulfill. And if they can't fulfill, they hurt their reputation. The other thing is surround yourself with reliable people. All right, when I was in the wellness plan, that company I talked about earlier, I had a great group of people around me, customer service and account management and all the others who supported me, were just as trustworthy as I were, and they had to be, because the person who is the least trustworthy becomes the weakest link in the chain. So surround yourself with reliable people and under-promise and over-deliver. And by doing these things, you can establish your reputation by being truthful and following through in a timely manner. And you protect your reputation by not overreaching, and especially not doing something that's contrary to your reputation. There's another great phrase I was taught. A good reputation takes a lifetime to establish and moments to destroy. Remember that. Now, I could end the sermon here, right? It's been a pretty good sermon, I think. Giving you some good advice to be honest. But that's just a moralistic sermon. That's just a do-good sermon. That's just a self help, or as one of my friends would say, a psychobabble sermon. All right? We as Christians need to take this even further. Doing good is okay for the secular world, but what about us as Christians? Everything we do is with the intention of bringing glory to God. All right, I can be the most honest person out there, but if I don't bring glory to God, it's all for naught. So to wrap it up and the call to action, yes, it is important. Develop a reputation for honesty. Let your yes be yes. Let your no be no, just as the Lord said. Be careful what you promise. Fulfill your promise in full and on time. Build that reputation. But in doing so, give glory to God. Why are you so reliable? Well, let me tell you, I serve the risen Lord, and it's his expectation of me that I be honest. And I don't want to fail him. I don't want to disparage his name. This is a Lord that I follow, and you can follow too. And then you open up the conversation to the gospel. Use your honesty. You and I know that there aren't as many honest people out there as you'd like to know. And when you find that person, and if you are that person, and you must be as a Christian, use it to open the door. If you can trust me with these little things, like business stuff, you can trust me with the big things, eternal life stuff. I've never lied to you. I've always held up my word. Let me give you the real word, the gospel of Jesus Christ. If you can believe me here, by God, you can trust me over here. And that's how you use your reputation to build the kingdom. And that's what it's all about. Use your reputation for honesty as a platform to proclaim the gospel of Jesus Christ. All God's people said, amen. And that gospel is simple, all right? It's the easy gospel message that we preach every Sunday. All right? For those of you who are unfamiliar with our tradition, we every service end with what's called the invitation, or some people refer to it as the altar call. It is the opportunity for someone or anyone or everyone who has heard the word of God preached, have the Holy Spirit come into them and move their heart to say, yes, I want to follow that Savior. I want to turn from my lying, sinful behavior and turn to good and follow the Lord. And this is that opportunity. If you have never done that before, the gospel is simple. You were created to be in a relationship with God. But you broke that relationship through your disobedience, which is called sin. There's nothing that you can do to fix it on your own. Maybe you swore to God and you profaned his name and you sinned against him. You can't go back and fix it by yourself. And that's why Jesus came. That's why God sent his only son, so that he would live the life you were supposed to live. He died the death that you deserve to die. And then he rose again, so that if you would just put your faith in him, you too will rise with him and have eternal life in his name. And so the only step left is for you to make that commitment, make that decision to follow the Lord. And that's the opportunity of the invitation or the altar call. Terry's going to come up here and lead us in an invitational hymn. I'm going to stand down here. If there's anyone here today who has never given their life to Christ and wants to become a believer today, come forward and let me know. And I'll pray with you and I'll welcome you into the kingdom of God. Now, if you are a believer and there's something on your heart that you want to share with me, you can come up and we can pray over that. If you are here today and you'd like to become a member of this church, you can come forward and make that intention known. But first and foremost, it's for those who want to give their life to Christ today. Terry?
The Bible says you are not your own. You are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God. Let's stand as we sing our invitational hymn. It's hymn number 305. Jesus paid it all.